Yes, I was answering how I got into voiceover, right? I love cartoons and video games, watched anime before I knew it was anime. Toonami was a big, you know, inspiration for me getting into anime when I actually knew what it was. Watched Outlaw Star, .hack, Cowboy Bebop, Gundam, Wing, G Gundam, all sorts of stuff. So just kind of like really sparked my interest in anime, and then I started looking it up more. And around when Final Fantasy X came out is when I was like super, super into voiceover, and I was like, oh, this is like a cool thing. Like it's happening more and more in video games, and like obviously, you know, it's in cartoons and stuff. And it was when I was really starting to realize that, like, you know, people do this for a job. This is really cool. So I looked it up on the internet. I would find websites where other people were also interested in voiceover. So I would like record my voice and upload myself to the internet, recording like Final Fantasy VII character lines and Final Fantasy VIII character lines, like anything I could find. And you know, just for fun. I wasn't any good at it, but you know, it was just a little hobby that I had for a while. And then a few years later, I realized that I was kind of, you know, it was probably something that I feel like I could have tried to do more, like professionally, if I worked hard enough. But you know, parents try to be a little bit more realistic than your big dreams can handle sometimes. So I was very much a homebody at the time, and very dependent on my parents. So my parents were like, "Oh, you know, you have to move to LA. You have to like learn how to drive, and like you don't do any of that right now. And so how do you think you're gonna be able to do this?" And I love my parents. They're like, they're super supportive of me now, but they just wanted to, you know, make sure I didn't endanger myself, I guess, because they're very protective of me. So that kind of put me down for a little bit, and I was like, yeah, maybe they're right. Maybe I can't do it after all. But I decided to do a bunch of conventions one year. And I did like I mentioned, if people missed it, I'm from Chicago. So I did, what was it, OhioCon, Anime Central, Otakon, and AX. Just attended all those conventions as a fan. Don't know how I did it. I was, I think, still in college at the time. Or high school, I can't remember. Again, no idea how I afforded doing all those conventions. But I went to Anime Expo specifically because they were doing AX Idol at the time, which is like, they do it differently now. Now they call it the open auditions, and it's set up a little bit differently. But AX Idol at the time was like, you sign up, you sit in a room with 300 other people who are also auditioning. First you pick a monologue, and you have to memorize that monologue, which is like something you don't have to do in voiceover normally. So I always thought that was kind of weird, but I'm pretty sure they did it because they made it a big stage show. So they wanted to make sure the people that won or like got past the preliminary round could go up on stage and, you know, do their performances in front of a huge crowd. So I auditioned for it, didn't get past the first round. So I was like, okay, well, you know, again, maybe this isn't for me, maybe I should just kind of quit. So I did the online stuff for a little while longer. Meanwhile, I'm getting my degree in animation, which was, you know, I have a passion for cartoons, so that was always, I just wanted to do something with cartoons, and I loved drawing at the time, so that just seemed the right thing to do for me. And at some point I started dating my boyfriend, who is also a voice actor, Lucian Dodge, if you guys know him. He's in a lot of shows with me. Total coincidence, I swear to God. but he lived in New York at the time, so we did long distance. And then eventually his agent in New York was like, you know, you need to be in California. Like, this is where you belong. Your passion is animation, so you should just go out there and, you know, work on your stuff and getting your career moving out there. So he's like, I'm moving to California. And I'm like, okay, I want to go there too, because animation is pretty big there. And I figured if voiceover was going to happen, the best place to happen was in California. So I moved out there with him about 6 years ago, 5-6 years ago, and was content just watching him. But because of the online stuff that I had done, I knew a lot of people who were already getting their foot into the industry. So I would get people who would recommend me for auditions and such. And I think it took about a year before, you know, I booked my first thing, which was actually recorded from home, which is pretty unusual. But it was for an indie game called Dust in Elysian Tale. if anybody's played that. If you haven't, it's a really good game. It's on sale very often. On Xbox, PSN, Steam, whatever you want to play it on. And so that was like my first like professional thing, technically. But then I took classes. I started taking classes with Tony Oliver, actually, who's also at this convention. If you want to learn more about voice acting from somebody who's been working a long time more than me, go to Tony's Adventures in Voice Acting panel tomorrow. So he'll have tons of stuff if you want to ask questions to him about that. But I took some classes with him. He liked me enough to recommend me to Bang Zoom, which is where he does a lot of his work and where I do a lot of my work now. And you know, I did a few like little auditions here and there, a few Walla sessions, which is like very minor background voices where you can't actually distinguish what you're saying because you're with a crowd of people. I'm just doing like these crowd scenes and stuff like that. And nothing happened for a little while. And then my boyfriend, who was already kind of starting to work with Bang Zoom at the time, got an audition for Pac-Man and the Ghostly Adventures video game, which is based off the TV show that's done in Canada. But they wanted to do the game in Los Angeles, so they wanted to get voice matches for the game. And he was like, oh, well, there's these two characters that I'm pretty sure you can sound pretty close to. So he asked if I could audition, since they already knew who I was. And they said, yeah, I auditioned for Pac-Man and Pinky. And they really liked my Pac-Man audition. So they sent me another audition for a anime adaptation of Treasure Island, where I auditioned for the lead boy, Jim Hawkins, in that. Within that week, I ended up booking both of them. So I'm Pac-Man in Pac-Man and the Ghostly Adventures, and then Jim in Treasure Island. And then it just kind of started rolling from there, honestly. Like, I think at the time I was there, kind of just go-to little boy voice for a while, because after that I got just auto-cast in, what was it, Atelier Eska and Lodgie, and Witch in the Hundred Night, and a few other things. And eventually Magi happened, and then, you know, it's not too long after that Kill la Kill happened, and so on and so forth, and it's been, you know, it's been really good for me. That was my long-winded story. Probably told more than I should have, but it's kind of, I don't know, everybody has, you know, their different stories. I didn't mention, I don't have a huge acting background, because I know a lot of people will ask, like, well, what should I do to get into voiceover? And I, along with other people, often suggest take acting classes. And sometimes I feel like a hypocrite saying that, because I don't have a huge acting background, but I definitely wish I had gotten into it sooner than I did. I forced myself, because I'm very stage shy, so doing conventions and stuff has really helped me kind of get out of my shell. And I had forced myself to do some acting classes in my senior year of high school, and that's kind of to the extent of what my acting, like the lessons that I've taken as far as that goes. And I did a few plays as background stuff, so. But I do suggest acting, don't be like me, because there are definitely things I go into the studio and I'm like, I should have been able to do that better. Like, I don't understand how to do this. And I get really down on myself about it, but so don't be like me. it'll be healthier for you, I promise, like mentally. But I do take a lot of voiceover classes even still. And I know a lot of people that have been working longer than me that still take voiceover classes, because I just think that you can never stop learning your craft. So it's kind of like being an artist. Like you draw every day, even if it's just for, you know, tuning your skills. Just practice everything and stuff like that. Yeah. Long-winded story, yay! Thanks for the question. Well, there's a lot of people in here now. Sorry. That fire alarm just attracted people, didn't it? Yeah. Did anybody have any other questions? Yes.
How did you feel when you found out Kill la Kill was going to air on Toonami?
Oh, man. How did I feel when I found out Kill la Kill was going to be aired on Toonami? I had heard rumors from Aniplex themselves saying that they were working on it. So I was kind of like, oh, that's okay. It might not happen, but I feel like it's probably likely. So keep it cool. Like, this could be a huge thing, like even huger than Kill la Kill itself was going to be. But like I said, like Toonami was a big part of me getting into anime just in general. So it was really special for me, honestly, to be a part of something to kind of make me feel like my career went full circle. And I've had a lot of those moments, honestly, in my career. But I feel like the Toonami thing was probably one of the most special for me.
Because you're now like, yes, you've had so many shows now.
Right? Yeah, yeah. It's been pretty much nonstop since Kill la Kill happened. Like, Kill la Kill aired, and I think it rerunned, right? It rerunned, and then Sword Art Online 2 happened. And now I'm doing Hunter x Hunter, so I haven't been off Toonami since Kill la Kill happened.
You solidified your spot on.
Yeah, yeah. People are calling me the Queen of Toonami now because I'm just there. And I'll be on it for a while because if, you know, the ratings keep going on Hunter x Hunter, like, hopefully it'll stay on. So keep watching Hunter x Hunter on Toonami so we can go through the whole 148 episode series. Like, that would be awesome. And it's just a good series, too. If you're not doing it for me, do it for the show. Everybody else is really great in it, too. So. Thank you. Another question?
In the purple.
Are you doing research on Hunter x Hunter as you go along, or are you just going in cold?
Yeah. Yeah, am I doing research on Hunter x Hunter? I think I know a little bit more than I should at the pace that I'm watching it currently. I don't read the manga. I've seen a little bit further, no, have I? Yeah, I've seen a little bit further in the Japanese version than where we are currently in Toonami, but I'm trying to experience the journey with Gon, honestly, so I haven't been keeping up too much on it, and I've just been watching the broadcast on Saturday nights, Sunday mornings, whatever that time slot is. But yeah, because I feel like I assume too much with characters when I do watch the series all the way through. And then for Hunter x Hunter, like, it's such a long series that I don't know if I'd have the energy to watch it again after that. Like, I'm sure it's great. I've heard it's amazing, and I've liked what I've seen so far. And I've heard it gets super crazy. People keep talking to me about the Chimera Ant arc, and I kind of know what happens because I've been spoiled a little bit. But I'm just really excited to see where it goes, and it's actually fun kind of experiencing things as Gon does, because I feel like a lot of the times, like, Hisoka does, like, these super crazy things, or, like, there's this one, it's not really a super spoiler, so I'll mention it, but, like, Gon, like, makes a slit in his eye because it's, like, super swollen, because I guess that's how you release the pressure, like boxers do and stuff like that. So he does that, and I had no idea it was coming up, so I had to, like, make a noise for it, so I had to see it over and over again to get, when we were trying to get the right noise to, for that scene, and I just kept, like, I couldn't look at the video anymore because it was just so gross to me. But then the Hisoka stuff is just really surprising to me all the time. They have to actually, because a lot of the time Keith has so little to do in the beginning as Hisoka that he's already in the mix, so I get to hear him. Or, like, even when I hear the Japanese and I'm getting ready to record my line, they have to mute Hisoka because I just can't take how creepy he is sometimes. So, or, like, I'll have to look away because we did... Yeah, I definitely have to look away sometimes because we just did one... we did an episode a few months ago where Hisoka's talking to Gon on the phone and you just see this pan up of his naked butt. And I'm just like, what is wrong with this guy? He's talking to, like, a 10-year-old on the phone. How creepy is this? This is so creepy. But the funny thing, I heard a funny story about, I know this is Kill la Kill panel, but, you know, whatever, it's fine. It's fine, whatever. Q&A, it's whatever. I heard from Tony Oliver about Keith's first session as Hisoka, and I guess he was getting, like, he was getting super creepy, which is, like, you know, Hisoka, so he took it as far as he could go. And Tony's like, actually, let's dial it down a bit. And the client was in the room at the time, and they're like, no. Make it creepier. Like, that's good, that's good. And Tony's like, okay, more pedophile-y. All right, let's just go in that direction. And Keith does such a great job as Hisoka. Like, he's a character that you just kind of love to hate, I think. And I find him super creepy, and I can't look at him a lot of the time, but... he's just so cool, I think. I buy a lot of merch with him on it now, because I'm like, oh, I love him, but I hate him. Stupid. And the cosplayers that do Hisoka are just so amazing. There's one in my line today, and I was like, this is so cool. I'm so excited. I love Hunter x Hunter. I'm excited to be in it. Thank you for the question. Did you have a question in the red behind?
Me?
Yeah, he can go first.
Could you say that Hisoka is basically an anime equivalent to the Joker?
I'd say Hisoka's pretty close to the Joker, yeah. I feel like, well, I'm not too big on my like DC lore, but I don't know. I don't know who I would say was like a crazier clown man, honestly. I don't know. But I'm not like as attached to the Joker, I feel like, as I am to Hisoka. But you could definitely equate them to each other, I think. Yeah, thanks. And behind him?
I have a couple questions.
Okay.
First of all, are you in the Kill la Kill cast? You guys are definitely getting back together to dub Space Patrol Luluku, right? Luluku?
I have no idea if that's being dubbed, honestly. And I don't know if they'd use any of us in it if they were, because we were already in Kill la Kill.
Yeah, no, they do, because I think a lot of the...
Oh, do they talk? Do they come back and talk?
No, there was a Kill la Kill dedicated episode, and then there was the voice of Nonon. She did that series, too.
I don't know. I honestly have no idea what they would do with that. It seems to kind of be a thing sometimes, though. I feel like a lot of people just tend to reprise the same roles that the Japanese actors do. Which I don't always agree with, but you know, if it works, if it's easier for some people, then you know, it is what it is. But
so for Hunter x Hunter, you're not doing the, you guys don't have like the whole thing dubbed out. You're doing it monthly.
We're not even halfway through yet. Like not even close to halfway through.
Are you guys what on the Greed Island arc right now?
We're starting it. I think we're starting it because they just found the tape recorder. If you guys know, right?
Yeah.
Which that was exciting. I was like, who's playing my dad? And they're like, we can't tell you. And I'm like, no, I need to know. I need to know who my dad is. I've been looking for him all this time.
You keep doing characters that they're trying to find.
I know, they're trying to find their dads, right?
You have dad complexes.
I do. Ryuko and Gon, and then I'm trying to think, I can't think of any other ones, but those are the two main ones. They're pretty. I feel like Aladdin maybe in a way, like secretly. Probably in the manga, right? Ugo is kind of like his dad. Aw, I miss Ugo. Do you have any more questions, or is that good?
Oh, I just lost my questions.
Oh, no!
So you're doing Hunter x Hunter as it goes on. So you guys go like back to the studio every month for like every week to keep recording new episodes?
It's usually like a week or two every month, yeah. Sometimes we just recorded a batch earlier this month, I think. And then I think we're going back soon, maybe, because I mean, obviously Tony Oliver's directing it. I keep pointing like he's right over there, but he's not. Tony Oliver is directing it, and obviously he has to be in town, so he's at this con also. So and I think he's staying out of town for a little bit because his family lives down here or something, so
yeah, because
we have to wait for him to come back. Yeah, but yeah, it feels a lot slower than it actually goes. I think for me, because I'm so used to when I play main character, not all the main characters, but I think I got spoiled with Ryuko, because when I did Kill la Kill, it was Ryuko had so many lines and we were taking our time and just going really slow and kind of perfecting it, because that's just kind of, you know, what Aniplex does with their stuff. I would record for Ryuko every day in a 2.5 week span. For Gon, it's actually, I maybe have like 2 or 3 sessions, because we move a lot faster on that show, and I feel like for the moment, it just comes a lot easier to me than Ryuko did, because Ryuko was like a completely different attitude for a character for me than I had done, and I was also less experienced at that point, so we just moved a lot slower. Not that I'm saying I'm perfect or anything now, but it's... Obviously, you get better with time, and you just learn how to do things more efficiently and stuff. So, it feels like it's, for being a main character, it just feels like I'm not doing as much as I could be, but I mean, I have to remember that I'm sharing the spotlight with, like, 4 or 5 other people, you know?
Because
it's got Killua and Kurapika and Leorio, and Hisoka, I'm sure, shows up more later, and then just everybody else in the show. There's so many characters, it's crazy. But yeah, I'm excited though.
So, you recently did the episode where
I feel like you're just interviewing me at this point.
No, honestly, like, I don't know if anyone else has questions. Like they can ask first.
We have a few. If you want to come back to you,
they can go first.
Okay, cool. Back here, yeah.
Yeah, I see the world of Kill la Kill. What do you think of how the show turned into its craziness? Because it really gets wild.
It's It does get really crazy. Back when I was recording Kill la Kill, though, that was when I was still kind of just, I would watch the series beforehand. And when we started, it wasn't completely finished yet, so I was still kind of like watching it week to week, trying to find out what would happen next. So going into it, I knew like what I was getting myself into. But for some reason, like even though I had seen the episodes, like it still surprised me sometimes, just because it was like, oh man, I watched this like a month ago, I forgot that this happens, or I was too busy reading the subtitles, so I didn't even see that happened over there, like this little subtext thing and stuff like that. So I don't know, there would still be times when I'd be like, oh, I'd have to like look away a little bit, because I'm not used to anime like Kill la Kill. I watch a lot of normally slice of lifey stuff. Like my favorite show is Fruits Basket. and I really loved like Your Line, Working on Your Line, April, because that's more my type, like the emotional, like feelsy type of shows. Like I really like that stuff. But yeah, it's sometimes I go back and watch it, and it's still kind of surprising. But I've learned to like shows like that now. But I don't know. It's just because that was one of those weird shows. Like I tried watching it the summer that it came out, because I was like, everybody's talking about this. It's pretty controversial right now. I'm going to see what it's about and see, you know, so I can talk about it with people or whatever if they wanted to talk about it. And I watched it in the first episode, and I'm like, ooh, what's going on? Like, I don't understand this. Like, why are her clothes coming off? I'm so confused. Why is that suit talking? Why is it drinking your blood? Oh, my God. And I just keep kind of going on because I just couldn't stop watching. Because I like to describe Kill la Kill as like a beautiful train arc, basically, at the beginning, and then it starts getting like really deep and serious, and you realize that it's kind of a parody of that genre, and it's very it doesn't totally take itself seriously sometimes, but it does when it has to, and there's a reason for all the fan service, you know, it's got, you know, all that stuff in it, and a lot of people relate it to fascism. And I don't like to think about that kind of stuff, so I'm like, oh, I'm just watching a cartoon that's got a good story to it, but, yeah.
In contrast to that, have you ever watched any, like, Free Speed of Truth stuff, like, the manga and all the Furikuri and the kind of shows? Because I love the anime.
When they were in Gainax and stuff? I had seen Furikuri. I like Furikuri. I'm glad they're bringing it back.
Wait, what?
Yeah, the Toonami is making a new Furikuri series.
Yeah, season 2 and 3.
Oh, shit.
I hope they bring back the cast, because Kari Wahlgren is Haruko.
No,
that's like.
They said they're gonna try to get everyone.
I hope so. I hope so.
That's news.
Gurren Lagann, that I liked it, but like I feel like everybody was treating it as like the next coming of Jesus. And I get it, like I can understand the appeal, but I guess I didn't attach myself to they're leaving because I don't like Gurren Lagann. I'm sorry. But I don't know, it was fine, but it's not a show that I would go back and rewatch. But the animation is great, you know, and I think that's the thing I love about Kill la Kill is just the fluidity of the animation and then the mixed media stuff that they throw in every once in a while. So I think Studio Trigger being like kind of its own thing now was the better move for them. But again, not that it was bad before. It just, I feel like it freed them to do a lot more and take more risks, for sure. Because, I mean, look at Kill la Kill. Kill la Kill is just a show about risks, pretty much. So, but yeah, I do like their stuff. And then I was in Little Witch Academia, which is also by Trigger. And I love Little Witch, so. And then I still have to watch Luluco and a lot of their other stuff that they've done. But yeah, I like them. I like their art style and I like their creativity. Yeah. Yeah, no problem. The questions, are we going to go back to the guy in the hoodie? Yes.
You guys ever pulling pranks on each other while in the recording studio?
Yeah. I'm bad at them, so I don't usually come up with them until I'm on. Is there like something in?
There's a bird.
There's a bird. That's what I thought.
Wait, what?
Oh. He has a question.
Don't lose your way, bird. Don't lose your way. Bert. Oh my gosh, that's scary. Oh no, I'm gonna be distracted now. Sorry. The question was, do we ever pull pranks on each? This bird's pulling a prank on me right now. Oh, he's cute. Do we ever pull pranks? Yes. I usually come up with stuff that's funny to do for like Bloop. But there's another. No, it's the same one. Never mind. he was over there last time I saw him, and then he was over there. I got confused. I usually come up with stuff after the fact for like bloopers and like voice bombs to leave for people, but I have had some written by Alex Juan David for me. And it was actually the story that I tell is my, it used to be my embarrassing booth story, but now it's in the Kill a Kill booper reel. So that's just a thing everybody knows about now. It was the fight scene in Kill a Kill with Gamagori and Ryuko. And at this point, you find out that Gamagori is a weird bondage freak.
Yeah.
And there's a scene during their fight where Ryuko's on the ground and her butt is facing the camera. And Gamagori is like in his full bondage getup. He's got the ball gag in his mouth. He's got weird tentacle things coming in and like slapping her on the butt. And it's very like, it's a weird scene. So the normal line in the scene is just, you know, Ryuko going, ow, 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 because she's getting whipped by these like nubby tentacle things. Who wouldn't be in pain? And so Alex, usually when he writes bloopers, he'll either have them already in there so you know what's coming and he's gonna ask you to do that, or he'll write them on the spot. I'm pretty sure he had already written this one, so I knew it was coming and it was listed as blooper, and I'm like, do I really have to do that, Alex? Like, do you really want me to see? He's like, yes, do it. And I'm like, but I feel really uncomfortable. He's like, no, do it. And I'm like, okay. So I'm not gonna do it verbatim because it's not an 18 plus panel, and I just don't want to do it. But it was basically me just going to Patrick Seitz, who plays Gamagori. Oh, Patrick, please don't stop. As Gamagori is whipping Ryuko.
Oh,
and I can't remember if we did it in one take or if I had laughed through it, but it sounds like something I would do, so maybe it was the second take that we got it in. But he ended up playing it for Patrick afterwards, and actually we can't unfortunately release the bloopers like clean, so you have to watch them on YouTube and people are laughing through them. But if you listen closely, you can actually hear Patrick laughing in the actual blooper.
Yeah.
And he talked to me about it afterwards, and he's like, oh my God, I like died. I couldn't record after that. I was like, oh, I was so embarrassed doing that. Because I'm not like an overly sexual person, so I get really uncomfortable about that stuff. Which is funny, because I was in Kill la Kill, and that can get a little weird sometimes. But a lot of the really weird stuff I wasn't a part of. Ryu and Sasuke bath scene. I'm glad about that. They pulled it off really well, though, I have to admit. But yeah, stuff like that. And then I'm working on a race right now, and we're actually, I don't know if they're going to release bloopers at any panel that we do, or if they're going to put them on the DVD or whatever. They never tell me what they're going to do with these. They just kind of keep them. So we've been working on bloopers for a race and stuff like that, and I actually threw a few in. And usually it's like really bad jokes about like how the boys are always hanging out with each other and stuff like that. Or like, we didn't record this, but there's a part, I don't want to spoil it for anyone, there's a part where one of the characters is like, he almost pushes like a lady down the stairs, basically. Like one of the little kids almost pushes a lady down the stairs because she's abusing her child. So he's like, I'm gonna get back this woman, she doesn't deserve to live. And then my character comes in and is like, no, don't do that. Like, what are you doing? Don't do that. She'll die if you do that. And then he also, like, my character confronts the main character and is also like, I saw you throw a window, or threw a window in that rock. I saw you throw a rock in that window and you broke the window. Like, why did you do that? And we're doing playbacks and stuff. And I just start laughing to myself. And the director's like, what's going on? I was like, I was just thinking about Klondike bars, and like, what if he did all that for a Klondike bar? I get really loopy when I record for serious characters, so that's how I entertain myself. But we didn't record that one. But yeah, we do leave like pranks and stuff for each other all the time. But like I said, I'm not as creative enough to do it, but I've heard other people do it for me, and they've left some pretty amusing ones that usually don't get shown anywhere, but I wish they were. They were shown, because some people are really funny about that stuff. They're really good at it. I can't remember who's like, I think I hear Michael Sorich is like constantly leaving jokes and stuff. I think most of his are in the Kill la Kill bloopers. He plays the dad in Kill la Kill. So yeah, the bloopers are fun. I wish they put more on DVDs, but they don't. Other questions? in the back over here.
Hi. So, question.
Yes.
How do you feel about some of the controversy that Kill la Kill has gotten, like, over media and stuff like that?
Oh, kind of like I was saying a little earlier, I honestly, the show, the aspect of the show, just looking at, you know, screenshots and stuff, kind of bothered me at first. Like, I didn't get it. But then after watching it and you kind of get deeper into the story after, like, episode, it kind of starts becoming clear after episode 3 that there's a reason why things are happening the way they're happening. And then I like to tell people to watch at least towards episode 4, because that's the budget episode, where they kind of just go all nuts. And then it gets a little bit more serious after that. And for me, like, I get why it's controversial, but, and I tell people all the time, like, when they ask me, should I watch Kill la Kill? And I'm like, well, you know, it's something you're going to love or you're going to hate. Like, I feel like there's no in-between for Kill la Kill. So either you kind of don't look past the surface of it, or you kind of, you watch it and you keep watching it and you find the deeper meaning behind everything. So, I mean, the controversy doesn't bother me. I understand why people wouldn't like it, but I personally think it's great, and I think people should watch it. Just to try it, you know? That's why I say up to episode 4, at least. Because if you just watch episode 1, you're like, no, like, what is this? Because it gets, like, really, like, the first Senketsu and Ryuko scene is, that's, like, trigger worthy. Nah, studio trigger, no. But, like, you know, when people use the term I'm triggered, like, that's definitely a moment. And my sister has a problem with that episode. So I'm like, no, you gotta keep watching it. That doesn't happen again, I swear. Like, it's fine. They're just doing that to shock you, you know? Like I said, it's a big risk-taking show. Like, they just took a bunch of risks. Because it was their first time, I think, doing something that big after splitting with Gainax. They're splitting from Gainax.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, it was their first thing.
But, yeah. People can find it controversial all they want. I think it's great. It surprised me, for sure. In a good way. In bad ways. Mostly good ways.
I
think
they're serious.
Yeah.
I like it.
It's good, yeah. Yeah. But you're not like, I don't know. Are you like iffy about it, or are you like, no, I think it's great?
I think it was good. I think it was a little far out there.
Okay. Yeah. But you still enjoyed it.
But like you said, after episode 4, I realized,
yeah,
okay, there's something else going on.
Yeah.
Here.
Yeah. So, it's very political. You know, there's a lot more to it.
Usually whenever I watch a series I don't take it seriously.
Okay, yeah. Yeah. Good. They're just cartoons, guys. They're fun things. Yes.
This is related to the budget episode of Kill la Kill.
Okay.
What is your opinion of the woman with the Tommy gun breastfeeding?
What?
Oh my god.
Oh.
It's interesting. Actually, it's funny you kind of mentioned that, because this is kind of sort of related, but I just was shown an article about women who do yoga and breastfeed. And I was like, why would you endanger a child like that? Why can't you do both of those things separately? Like, there's a time, there are enough hours in the day to do each thing separately. Like, why do you have to do yoga while you're feeding your child like this? It's weird. But yeah, she could have, why did she have to, you know, feed her child while she was shooting stuff? Why couldn't she have taken a, I don't know, I don't plan on ever having, well, I don't want to say ever, but right now I don't plan on having kids, so I guess I don't understand it quite as well. I'm kind of coming from it from an extremist side, I guess, but I'd just be like, put the child down, like, or have somebody else shoot it. Like, why did she have to shoot it? I just thought it was one of those, like, really far out there kind of things that I don't really think about until people like mention it like that, you know? But it took me for a surprise. That whole episode is just one thing after another, though.
I feel that in that episode, they purposely did it that way just for the comedic aspect.
Yeah, for sure.
It was
like,
a reference.
I think of, like, Gurren.
Yeah, that was a big reference episode, wasn't it?
Like,
yeah.
Gurren Lagann's fourth episode was kind of, like, off.
Yeah.
Very much
Yeah.
But I think it was more so of a budget issue for them.
Yeah.
Rather than Kill la Kill. They probably did that as probably a homage to, hey, this is our episode 4. So
let's yeah.
Make it.
Yeah. I hope that's the thing with them now. Yeah. They just do episode 4 like really weird and crappily sometimes. But yeah. It's a really fun episode though. I had a lot of fun with that one. Because that's the episode where you realize that they're not taking themselves seriously, you know, and they're just having fun with it. And then it goes back to being serious. And stuff goes down. Yeah.
Yes, in the front.
To you, knowing that you're cast for a character, how long is the usual time for you to actually be able to announce that you're this character, you know?
Yeah, like how long does it take from, like, the recording process to being able to announce?
Yeah.
It really varies, honestly. Kill la Kill was like, I want to say like 5 or 6 months, maybe. Because usually the companies want to do like big press announcements, and you have to wait until then to be able to. For Kill la Kill, they did a live stream thing, I think, and then they had me on the show or something like that. I don't remember exactly how it went down. But usually, you know, they'll wait for big conventions, and they'll announce stuff there. But yeah, like I said, it really depends on the company and the show. I did a show called Yuki Yuna is a Hero.
I watched it.
Yeah, I play Fu in that one, and that was the quickest turnaround I've ever done on an anime. Honestly, we recorded it 2 months before they announced it, and that was really weird. But then they also, like, they announced that they were doing the dub and that it was coming out, but they didn't announce the cast, actually. So we had to be like, hey, this is, like, out now. Can we talk about it? Like,
yeah, because I follow the whole cast on Twitter. And
yeah.
Talk about it. I was like, what is this show? And then I watched it, and then it was like, oh, this is fun. And then, the rest of the show happens.
So yeah, it gets, it's a Monica-type series. I haven't seen Monica, so I know people compare it a lot. Is it darker than Monica? Or Monica's darker? Or?
Monica's way darker than
Yuki. Okay. But it's one of those, like, we're super cute, but, like, bad stuff happens to us.
Yep.
Magical Girl series. It's on Netflix right now, I believe. So it's, like, 12 episodes, 13 episodes?
Yes, 12, 13.
But, yeah, I mean, long answer short, it's just, it varies. I've waited a year to announce stuff before.
So, how does it feel when you're like, you finally say you're a character?
Oh, it's like, God, it's like the world lifted from your shoulders. There's a project I had worked on earlier this year that I'm just dying to talk about, and I just emailed asking if they knew like when we were going to be able to talk about it. So this production studio person was like, okay, I'll email Japan for you and see if we can do anything about it. And she got back to me like yesterday, and she's like, yeah, sorry, you can't announce it until it comes out. And I'm like, no, this is so painful. NDAs are the worst.
Because I follow one of the other Ericas,
yeah.
Ms. Harlicker, and she's just been teasing.
She's been teasing about the same thing over and over again, and I think they keep telling her that they're going to announce it, and then they keep taking it back, which is a thing that happens. That happened to us with Love Live, actually. They didn't let us talk about that until it was released. So, but they had teased us for months that they were going to announce it, and I kept taking it back. And it sucked, because I was super excited about that one. A lot of us were, so. But it depends. Depends on how organized the company is. Depends on what Japan wants sometimes. Depends on the turnaround, because sometimes the recording stuff happens like really soon after, really soon before they're going to release it. But yeah, it all varies, honestly. Thank you. Over here.
Hello, yes. Erica.
Hey.
Two questions,
yes.
If that's okay.
Yep.
So the first question is, when they were telling you the introduction of Sailor Uranus,
yes.
In Sailor Moon, and they had to explain to you her relationship with Sailor Neptune, how did that go?
I mean, I knew. I'm not homophobic, so it didn't bother me. I think it's just funnier that, you know, a lot of people bring up the cousins thing from the 90s series.
Because they were portrayed that way.
No, yeah, I know, because the 90s wasn't ready for a gay relationship on a kid's show, basically. But, I mean, it doesn't bother me. me and Lauren have become closer friends because of it. Which is
not like that, people. Take it easy.
Well, somebody said they were gonna like wait for our wedding to happen earlier today. Because we're like, I love you, waifu. And it's funny. I give her gifts all the time of her characters. It doesn't bother me. I think it's cool. I'm glad that we live in an age that accepts that for what it is, and that Viz is redubbing it, and they're doing it the way it was meant to be from the Japan release.
And then my second question is somewhat related, because I looked up your IMDb page really quick just to make sure that you voiced the original.
Yeah, thank you for that.
And I saw that you did the voice for Rainbow Dash in Death Battle.
Oh.
So how that...
Oh, wait, I actually don't do the original Uranus, if that's what you were saying.
Oh.
It says I do... It says I was in the, like, whatever 2019-90 whatever version, mm-hmm. because that's just when the series came out.
Yeah.
But I was 13 years old when that aired.
Right.
So that definitely was not me. But we're just in, like, Stephanie, Amanda, Lauren, me, and everybody else that's in it now for the Viz Media dub. They just started working on it like 2 years ago, and then me and Lauren just started last year. Yeah.
The Rainbow Dash question.
Yes. The Rainbow Dash. I played a Rainbow Dash in a Death Battle thing, like, way back when. It kind of leads into, I don't know if you heard for the first story I was telling about how I got into voiceover, but...
No, I came into the panel. I'm sorry, guys.
Oh, no, it's fine. I was just referring back to when that happened, if, in case other people weren't here.
Yeah.
But Ashley Ball in Canada does... Rainbow Dash in My Little Pony.
My Little Pony, yeah.
And it's funny because actually the reason why my boyfriend Lucian asked if I could audition for Pac-Man and the Ghostly Adventures was because one of the characters is played by Ashley Ball, and because I would do Rainbow Dash impressions for fun, he recommended me to the studio to be able to audition for Pac-Man and Pinky. So.
But like Screw Attack just like called you up and said, hey, like...
They emailed me one day, because I had actually done a few other things. Like I did Epic Cupcake Time and Epic Pie Time, I think, really short stints.
Yes.
And I guess they liked it enough, found my contact info, and then asked me to do it. And I was like, sure, why not? Because
cool. Awesome.
I still wasn't like doing professional stuff at that point. I was just kind of doing it for fun.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Awesome, thank you.
Thanks. Yes.
Going back to one of your favorite genres that you would like to watch, specifically the slice of life part,
mm-hmm.
I would definitely reminisce on how in some of my hobbies shape myself as a person,
mm-hmm.
and personality. If there was any series you would reminisce to us on that helped shape you who you are, or rather one of the things that really somewhat made an impact throughout your life, it would be a great thing to share. Or if it's just something for fun, that's just as much great.
Ooh, that's a hard question. Ooh. I don't know, I feel like I take a little bit from a lot of stuff that's obviously not like the super far-fetched stuff, but some of the stuff that's just closer to being more dramatic and more real to someone. This might be cheating. I'm in Your Lie in April, obviously, but I haven't gone through anything that Tsubaki's gone through, but just kind of portraying her character, I felt a lot of empathy for her. So there are definitely times when, you know, Tsubaki's crying in the show, and I had to record that, and I was actually crying because I just felt so bad for her, you know, that she had loved this person for so long, and they were just kind of living their life not really knowing that she loved them. And for a while she didn't admit that she loved him either, so she's just living this lie and kind of letting him get into the hands of another girl pretty much, and just watching it all happen. And then she kind of breaks down at one point and is like, you know, she eventually tells him that she's liked him, and he's like, what? And then she kind of avoids him for a little while. So
oh boy.
Yeah. I guess I kind of relate to it in a way that I hold a lot of things in, but then when like it finally does just keep piling on and piling on, that's when I kind of explode. And I feel like Tsubaki does that a lot too, where she just kind of lets it all go.
I'm just as guilty in that aspect too, because actually I'm a musician, and mm-hmm. it's been 11 years from practicing guitar. So, you know, it's one of those series that definitely draw my interest
because
of many of the expectation, anticipation that I would see, because I've been there, done that. I just came back from Texas, and, you know, it has not been the best of adventures, but it has been in terms of being able to being independent. That is for sure. I definitely realize a lot about myself that I'm not working on, and a lot of the things that definitely pull me through as well is definitely series like Kill la Kill or Aladdin, which I'm still trying to watch, you know. Many of these things, you know, really does, when you allow it, take your mind off of the reality that
you're trying
to be on, while at the same time makes you realize some of the things that you actually should be grateful for.
Right, exactly. Yeah, I totally agree with that so much.
And the best part about it all is, too, is just some of the fun things. Like, that guy kind of beat me, too, and I wish I asked about the prank one, because that was a really good question.
Yeah, it was fun.
Because to this day, I'm sure he's going to probably see this. I'm going to literally ask Patrick Seitz for my first hug, because I never asked.
Yeah?
Because the guy...
He gives good hugs.
I figured.
I'm just saying from experience.
No, because the guy's a freaking Viking.
He's a giant. He's a big teddy bear.
The guy's an awesome Viking. I freaking can't wait.
Yes, yes. But yeah, stuff like that. I feel like Ryuko was really big on me too, just because I kind of grew with her, and the characters that I can kind of grow with. Like I feel like I'm growing with Gon too, and that always makes a big impact on me when I kind of just go through that journey with them. But yeah, that was a good question. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
What was your favorite scene in Hunter
Hunter? My favorite scene in Hunter x Hunter. To dub. There's an episode I just did pretty recently. I don't want to give away any like big things, but if you've seen it, it's Gon and Killua are in Whale Island. They had, like, just got back there, and they're like talking underneath the stars, and I thought that was a really sweet moment. Actually, me and Christina B, who plays Killua, always have, like, you know, a silly relationship on Twitter. I used to live with her, actually. We were roommates for a while, and she's super sweet, really good friend. And after I recorded that scene, I took a screenshot that I found on the internet, and I just said, and it has their, like, images and that weird, like, juxtaposed, like, the transparent, where it's like you can see their faces, but they're not totally clear, so they're just kind of blended in with the sky, the starry sky. So I sent that to her, and I'm like, thinking of you. So I do like silly things with her all the time, like that. So, yeah, that was a fun one. There's a lot of really good things. The fight with Gon and Hanzo that aired on Toonami last weekend was intense. It was really cool. I was messing with Ray about that too. In the hat. I feel like sometimes there are things, this is more like a script adaptation thing. There were times when I was recording for Magi where he would use the word, like, I want to say he would use the word man sometimes to talk to Alibaba, and I was like, this just doesn't feel right to me, but at the time I didn't want to speak up. And sometimes I feel like I don't speak up about stuff. Like, there's this one character I was playing, they kind of can't talk about yet, but she uses the word, like, sweetie a lot, and I'm just like, this just doesn't feel right to me, but at the same time I don't want to, like, stress out over them having to rewrite the line and stuff. But there are times when it depends on who I'm working with. Like Alex Von David, who records who directs Kill la Kill and Erased and Sword Art Online 2, I'll speak out if I have, like, if I don't like a take that I did, or if I want to try something new, or if it's like, I don't know, like, I can't wrap this line around my head, like, it just doesn't seem right to me, it doesn't feel right. He's usually pretty good about, because he writes his own scripts too, as well as directs the shows, but he's so great. I love working with him. Like, I used to be afraid of him when I worked on Kill la Kill, because he's like this big, tall guy, and he's like, you never can tell if he's joking or not. But I think we have a better relationship now, so it's a lot easier to work with him. Erased has been so easy. In a way, because he's still picky about stuff. But he knows what he's doing, so usually there isn't too much of a problem with him. But if I do have ideas and stuff, he's more than willing to listen and like have us try things. And sometimes he likes it better, sometimes he doesn't. You know, it's just kind of a working relationship process kind of thing. But if I feel like it's not appropriate, or like if I've had experiences where the director just kind of passes over it, sometimes I won't say anything. But it feels wrong sometimes, but I just do it anyway, because it's like you're getting paid to listen to people, basically. So the director knows best sometimes, not always. next turn? Yeah. How am I doing? The weekend's been really good. I haven't been sleeping well, but I am here, and I'm glad to be here. I had a great autograph session just earlier today, and I have another one soon after this at 5:30. And I'm here with all of you guys and your beautiful faces. But it's been good, and I hope you've been good as well. Just going with the flow, kind of, yeah. Are you all tired like I am? Yeah. It's already like, oh, it feels like a Sunday. But I just got to be here. I love doing these things. So, yeah. Thanks for asking. you haven't asked one yet, right?
I was wondering, because of the gap of time that can come between dubs and the original releases, what are your thoughts on a bridge series, and do they influence you on your takes on characters sometimes, if you ever have seen any?
I actually don't watch a bridge series. I've tried watching a few. I don't understand the humor, so I don't tend to watch them. I know Little Karibo very well, actually. Sometimes I watched his Naruto bridge before, and that's probably the funniest one I've seen, just because I used to watch a lot of Naruto, and a lot of the stuff is like, it rings a bell with me, I guess. But I didn't watch like Yu-Gi-Oh, so I don't get into that. I didn't really watch Dragon Ball Z, so I don't get into that one. Those are the big ones that I know of. But I don't know, I just, it doesn't strike a chord with me usually. I have a very specific sense of humor, I think. I have very dry, witty sense of humor usually, so it's kind of hard to get me to laugh sometimes about certain things that I don't understand, so yeah. But I mean, a lot of people are kind of getting their foot into places from or through a bridge series, and you know, more power to them if that's how it works. So it's nice to see people being so creative, I think, but I personally don't watch them. Yeah. Why do you do one?
No.
Are you trying to advertise in my panel? No, I'm kidding. Thanks for the question.
Other questions? We started at 3:45, right?
Yeah.
And then the fire alarm happened. And then the Fire Nation attacked. we have like a minute. So who has last few questions? Let's go back to you since it's been a while. Hey again, how's it going?
This is a stupid question.
Okay.
Asking you about it. Did you and the Kill the Kill cast, did you guys ever catch on to the joke while you guys were recording, or while was it airing, that the plot line to Kill the Kill, they had essentially the same plot line as the one from Sonic Adventure 2?
I don't think the cast caught on to that, but I've had a lot of people bring that up to me.
Yeah.
I actually...
you have to search this up. Kill the Kill has...
It's like loosely based theory. It's kind of like the whole, like, you know, Little Mermaid and Frozen and whatever so-and-so is in the same timeline. It's like one of those weird theories.
Yeah.
But a lot of people bring that up to me because it's funny because Satsuki is generally associated with the color blue, and Ryuko is associated with black and red, and she's kind of like angsty and revenge-filled Shadow is. So it was funny because I was at Yomicon, and they had key cards for their hotel that were, I don't know if there was a Sonic one, but the one I had Knuckles on it. So I actually took a picture of it, and I was just like, this seems familiar somehow. And I had a few people that were like, no, you just did not. And I was like, yeah. So I like to like feed into some of that stuff sometimes, just because it amuses people, and I like being an idiot on Twitter, so I just... What's up? No!
If you were a character,
say
what character would you be?
You want to hear the answer to this.
Oh my goodness.
But you do it so well. You know me like you're not someone who's doing a panel next in here, and you know somebody who's been signing autographs. All right, do you have a panel in here next? Do you have Sailor Jupiter? Sailor Jupiter. Sorry, I only got 4 hours of sleep. How about you?
30 minutes.
What?
I win. Anyway.
Sorry. But yeah, I'm pretty much up. So if you guys want to stick around for Amanda, or totally leave with me, that's fine too. Like, nobody wants to talk to Amanda. No, I'm kidding. But you guys should talk to Amanda. Amanda's really funny. Way funnier than me. And she does a web series that she could tell you all about that I was in for a little bit. Yeah. Good times. But yeah, thanks for coming, guys. Stick around for Amanda's panel.